Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Farewell to the Horse, A Cultural History by Ulrich Raulff, translated by Ruth Amidazi Kemp, read by Matthew Waterson. The Long Farewell. To be born in the countryside in the mid-20th century meant growing up in an old world. Little had changed from the way of life that existed 100 years before. Sluggish by nature, the agricultural realm ticks over at a sleepy pace. Not so for the children of the city. Their environment was one of engines and decay, the result of mechanized destruction. The countryside lagged behind, dragging its feet for nearly a century before the sudden leap into technological modernity. Farm machinery was on the increase in rural settings, certainly, whereas back in the mid-19th century, such machines were still rare, experimental exceptions. Over the course of the 20th century, these machines became smaller and more practical, gradually shaking off the resemblance to medieval siege engines or huge robotic dinosaurs. With increasing regularity, they would be seen in the fields, tugged along now by small tractors. If such vehicles were known at all a century ago, they tended to be colossal steam engines. By the mid-20th century, tractors could muster 15 or 20 horsepower. They had short, catchy names, such as Fendt, Deutz, Lanz, or Fawn. And with few exceptions, such as the Grey Lance, they were painted green. Looking back, they seem like fragile grasshoppers compared to the mammoths of today, with their 200 horsepower engines and soundproof cabs. Aside from these noisy pioneers of rural mechanization, whose jerky movements and clamor were at odds with the pastoral idyll of the 19th century, little had changed. Horses, heavy Belgian coldbloods, strong trakeeners, and stocky halflings were still the most commonly used and most widespread forms of transport and draft power on narrow, winding byways, on sloping fields, and in wooded ravines. My winter memories are of the water vapor rising from their breath and their warm flanks. My image of summer is filled with the scent of their brown hair and glossy manes. I still shudder when I recall the horror I felt when I first saw the square-headed iron nails being hammered into what I thought of as the soles of their feet. It was only in church, in the Passion of Christ, that I had seen such grim scenes. Later, whenever I heard someone say they had nailed it in the sense of successfully achieving something, I couldn't help but picture those square-headed horseshoe nails. For farmers who still lived off the land and had not yet exchanged their modest economy for factory work, the stables were one of the smaller but nobler parts of the enterprise. Cattle, pigs, and chickens were more omnipresent, more pungent, and made a far greater racket. In a word, they were the plebs of the farmyard. The horses, in contrast, were rare, precious, and sweet-smelling. They were more refined in their eating habits and more spectacular in their suffering. Their bouts of colic were especially fearsome. Standing in their stables like living sculptures, they would nod their shapely heads, signaling distrust or suspicion with a twitch of their ears. The horses had their own pasture, to which never a cow would stray, to say nothing of the pigs or geese. No farmer would consider surrounding his horse's meadow with the barbed wire which was often used to enclose sheep and cattle. For the horses, a bit of wood or a simple electric fence was sufficient to stop them escaping. One does not incarcerate aristocrats. It is enough to remind them of their word of honor. I picture myself and my grandfather, one day in the mid-1950s, standing on a hill from where we could see our farm and the surrounding land. In the distance was a patch of deciduous woods, through which a narrow track wound its way up the hill. For a while, the silence that usually hung over the rural solitude had been ripped apart by something that resembled a hunchbacked ant, slowly and noisily heaving itself up the hill. As it approached, this gigantic ant revealed itself to be one of my uncle's ancient Mercedes diesel cars. The weighty vehicle drew nearer with Olympian gravitas. My grandfather made a disparaging remark about it, which included the words threshing box, and watched with growing skepticism as my cousin, the man at the helm of this beast, turned off the hard track and headed across the horse's paddock straight towards us. After just a few meters on the damp grass, he lost control and the vehicle jolted sideways, skidded, and made a dive for the electric fence where it became entangled and finally came to a halt by a tree stump in a cloud of dark blue smoke. As the smoke receded, the Olympian emerged into view, the thunderbolts he hurled now trapped within. Ensnared by the electric fence, the car was transformed into a kind of inverse Faraday cage, its numerous metal parts conducting each surge of electricity onto the occupant within. After all the attempts by the driver to extricate the vehicle had failed, a heavy Belgian draft horse came to the rescue. Hitched up to the diesel's rear bumper, this good-natured giant heaved the wrecked vehicle back onto solid ground. Everyone knows the JMW Turner painting of a steam tug puffing away as it tows a proud warship, the Fighting Temeraire, sails furled to her final resting place in the shipbreaking yard. In our case, though, fate intervened, with accustomed irony, to turn the tide of history. Here, it was the horse, history's retired war veteran, who was called on to tow the diesel engine. The old world was back in the harness, slogging away in the service of the new. In fact, by this point, the matter had already been decided once and for all. Man and horse had set off on their separate paths. Since man preferred in future to travel his path in a motor vehicle, he then had it leveled and topped with asphalt. Our equine friends were literally outrun, overtaken, left behind. Horses were consigned to that part of reality which Condoleezza Rice, former US Secretary of State, once described as the roadkill of history. For centuries, mankind had always pictured the fate of the vanquished as those who had been trampled under the hooves of the triumphant. Now, in the transition from the 19th to the 20th century, it was the horse that was trampled under the hooves, or rather, the wheels, of history. For most of recorded history, horses had helped man defeat his most dangerous enemy, other men. Now they were relegated to the edge of the road and to seeing their conquistador trundle off into the distance. 600 years of gunpowder had done nothing to move horses from their rightful place as man's most important weapon of war. But 100 years of mechanized warfare sufficed to render them obsolete, vanquished by recent history. As simple and straightforward as the parting of ways between man and horse seems, the segregation of mechanical and animal strength, it was in reality nothing like as clear-cut. Mankind was not made up of riders and coachmen one day, and motorists the next. It took several phases over the course of 1.5 centuries for man and beast to go their separate ways. From the early 19th century, which saw engineers experimenting with steam-powered vehicles and motors, through to the mid-20th century, when motorized automobiles overtook the horse numerically as the prime mode of transport. The most surprising thing at first glance is that for most of this period, the use of horses continued to increase rather than to fall, as one might expect. It was only towards the very end of the period, the years following the Second World War, that the use of horses receded, and rapidly at that point. To that extent, the last century of the era of the horse witnessed not only the exodus of the horse from human history, but also its historical climax. Never before had humanity been as heavily dependent on horses as when Benz and Daimler's first internal combustion engines began rattling away in Mannheim and Stuttgart. Having said that it took 1.5 centuries, when I occasionally speak of the last century of the horse, it is not out of intellectual laziness or because it has a better ring to it. The end of the horse age fits almost exactly with what has tended to be called the long 19th century, the period starting with Napoleon and ending with the First World War. Since then, virtually every kind of technology for which horses traditionally provided the necessary traction power, from the transport sector to the military, has switched over to combustion engines or electric motors. In practice, this changeover was a considerably drawn-out process. The two world wars prompted a mercilessly heavy reliance on horses, and it was only after the middle of the century that traction power was cheap enough to lead to a dramatic decline in horse numbers in Europe. Now, though, the separation of man and horse is not only a done deal, it is also a finished process. Seen through the eyes of a historian, the parting of man and beast forms the central chapter in the story of the demise of the predominantly agricultural world. Until the mid-20th century, the landscape of the mechanized and technically advanced civilizations of the Western world was still strongly influenced by rural constructs, by farming villages, markets, livestock herds, and crop fields. Going another 50 years back in time, to the beginning of the last century, the dramatic departure from the apparently pastoral, natural environment is even more conspicuous. In 1900, writes the philosopher Michel Serres, most people on our planet were working in agriculture and the food industry. Nowadays in France, just as in comparable countries, farmers make up nearly 1% of the population. This is, without a doubt, one of the most profound historical breaks with tradition since the Neolithic era. It is also through the prism of this radical transformation to life and working conditions in the rapidly industrializing countries that we need to view the departure of the horses. This farewell represents a phase in the withdrawal of mankind from the analog world. Nietzsche referred to the death of God to describe one of the most unsettling experiences faced by 19th century man, the loss of a transcendent sphere formerly deemed to be secure. People felt that the metaphysical realm was slipping out of their grasp. The citizens of the 21st century know a similar discomfort, finding themselves in the process of losing their grip on the physical realm. In a traditionally agrarian country like France, where the ancient Roman sense of culture has never been forgotten, namely agriculture and viticulture, the disruption to farming was naturally perceived as particularly dramatic. The gods of wine and fruit withdrew from sight, and with them disappeared the old way of life for mankind. The farewell to the horse has become a historical marker for the loss of the rural world. I belong to a vanished people, laments art historian and writer Jean Clair. When I was born, we still made up 60% of the French population. Today, it is no more than 2%. One day, it will be appreciated that the most important event of the 20th century was not the rise of the proletariat, but the disappearance of farming. Farmers and producers have vanished, and with the farmers, and sometimes before them, went the animals. The horses were the first to go in the late 50s. They became redundant, and they disappeared forever. Viewed through the lens of the philosophy of history, the separation between man and horse seems like the dissolution of an idiosyncratic workers' union. In a communal effort, albeit one imposed unilaterally, the two species together accomplished what Hegel called the work of history. By strange coincidence, which may invite speculation, this age-old workers' union came to a bitter end during almost exactly the same time period as that which divided Hegel's Lectures on the Philosophy of World History from the mid-20th century theories that declared the end of history. Exactly 15 decades span the end of the age of the horse from the first hints in the early 19th century up to the final nail in the coffin in the middle of the 20th. Those decades stretch from Hegel, who in 1806 described the French emperor as a world soul on horseback, to Arnold Galen, who in the 1950s and 1960s developed his theory of the post-histoire. The philosopher and anthropologist Galen distinguished between three distinct world eras. A very long period of prehistory was followed by a phase of intrinsically agrarian history, which was in turn superseded by industrialization and the entry into the phase of post-history. As though clinging to this schema, the historian Reinhard Koselleck, speaking for the first time in 2003 of the Age of the Horse, also outlined three great world epochs. He splits the entirety of history into the pre-horse age, the horse age, and the post-horse age. The historian resorted to the simplicity of this chronological three-field system because he saw in it a new perspective on world history, knowing full well that any attempt to divide history into periods relies on questions which alter our perspective. I'm searching for a criterion that avoids all boundaries between old, middle, and recent history. With my exploration of the end of the era of the horse, I share Kosalek's aspirations. Unlike him, however, I am focusing attention on the relatively narrow transition zone in which this particular departure from history takes place. The process of de-horsification, as Isaac Babel described it, obies loscherni, has its own duration and its historical power. It occurs as a result of the dissolution and transformation processes that dragged on for over a century. In certain respects, they are still unfinished to this day. It is not only in Kosalek's narrative of 2003 did we see the long shadow of the era of the horse, it is also felt in our stories, in our images of everyday life, and in our figures of speech. In fact, the end of the era of the horse spans not only a relatively long time period, but also a wealth of realities and observations from the most diverse spheres of life. No other historical and natural being, except man, presents such a compelling case for an histoire totale. There are countless histories waiting to be told in which horses play a major role. The story of technology, of transport, agriculture, energy, war, and urbanization. But alongside these physical histories of the material world, other less tangible histories jostle for attention. Stories of knowledge, ideas and concepts, stories of art and symbolism. Even recent approaches in historiography, such as sound history, the acoustic texture of worlds long gone, find a privileged subject in the horse. All these narratives are plausible, and all the horses they describe did indeed exist. Whether they were the products of breeding, the outcome of research, or artistic creations, none of these beings is more real or more valid than another. Graffiti on a wall, a metaphor, the shadow of a dream. None of these is less real than a being of flesh and blood. History is made up of one as much as the other, and not only the history of the horse. Jules Michelet once said that history seems to him, at the same time, to be insufficiently material and insufficiently spiritual. This is perhaps a risk worth taking when we embark on the history of the horse, seeking to capture both the material and the spiritual, or intellectual, as we might call it today. At the beginning of the era of the horse, there is a paradox, as it were. The paradox of the entire history. An intelligent mammal, man, asserts its power over another mammal, the horse. We domesticate and breed horses, befriend them, and use them for our own ends. The astonishing thing is that the whole process still functions even if mankind's end goals run contrary to the nature of his four-legged colleague. Unlike man, the horse is by nature a prey animal, which flees at the slightest hint of danger. When it is not competing with peers for sexual purposes, the famous sparring stallions, it has no need of confrontation or quarrels. The instinct to seek out prey is quite unknown to the great vegetarian. It is the horse's speed when it needs to flee that allows it to escape the threat of hunters and carnivores. This is precisely the characteristic that attracted the attention of another mammal, the human. It was not as a source of protein, not even as a beast of burden or of tensile strength, that the horse first came into the spotlight in human history. Had it been restricted to the role of pack animal, it would have languished with the ox and the ass in the backyard of history, lurking by the tradesman's entrance. It was only as a swift animal of flight that the horse took its place at the forefront of the symbiosis of history and nature, the top spot to which, for all the historical success of the camel and the elephant, the horse could assert its right unchallenged for 6,000 years. Above all, the merit that earns horses their place in history is their speed, something which was clearly recognized by German historian and philosopher of history, Oswald Spengler. For almost 6,000 years, rapid acceleration and high velocity were characteristics associated with the horse, although also with the camel in Arabia. To be fast meant being mounted, a unique historical discovery which, five generations after the invention of motorized vehicles, is now largely forgotten. The horse was the speed machine par excellence. As such, it allowed the domination of territory to a degree that would have been unthinkable without this capacity for speed. Thanks to the horse, distant territories could be conquered and vast dominions could be established. Indeed, they could also be secured and maintained. Following on from Nietzsche, Spengler called it great politics, die große Politik. The horse paved the way, historically speaking, for a new kind of power politics, the politics of conquest, to be engaged in on a major scale. As a machine of speed, the horse was a first-rate weapon of war. Its ability to make light work of great distances led to an exponential increase in the scope of communication networks. The horse's capacity to be tamed and bred turned the swift horse into a domestic animal that could be steered by man. In a word, as a vector in animal form, the horse became a political animal and the most important companion of Homo sapiens. Thus, we return to the initial paradox. As a vector, it is far from rare for the civilian saddle horse or draft horse to be transformed into a military war horse. Time and again, the peaceful grazer is denied its natural instinct and forced by man to accompany him into battle, to trample his enemies into the soil. Against its nature, the terrified prey animal is turned into an incarnation of terror which drives the predator, man, to flee in droves. Who would risk being trampled under a horse's hooves? The prey animal, put to use as a physically superior weapon in the battles between the predator, man, and his own kind. This is the primary dialectic of the age of the horse, the source of tension which spans the Centurion Pact. Compared with this historic alliance, every other covenant into which mankind has entered within his history has been fragile and ephemeral. Not even man's relationship with his gods has shown a comparable degree of stability. All the more remarkable, then, is its sudden breakup. At the very moment when the alliance had reached its strongest and most intense bond, it began to fall into inexorable ruin. Almost silently, and quite unnoticed by most contemporaries, this alliance disintegrated into its component parts. The great edifice crumbled, bringing about the unsung demolition of 6,000 years of centurion companionship. What happened next is the stuff of a satyr play. While one party to the treaty, the human side of the old alliance, entered into all manner of short-lived dalliances with various kinds of machinery, automobiles, aircraft, and computers, the other party, the horse, went into semi-retirement with a part-time job as a recreational item, a mode of therapy, a status symbol, and a source of pastoral support for female puberty. Henceforth, horses would be granted only fleeting appearances in their archaic role as inspirer of terror when required to intimidate picketing workers or drive rallies of protesters out of shopping precincts. Alongside its ultimate rise and fall, throughout the 19th century, the horse enjoyed a colossal literary and iconographic career. The great novels of the last century of the horse, the ones set on terra firma rather than on the high seas at any rate, have horses in their very fabric, equine motifs running through them like tendons and veins. This is true even for the most cosmopolitan writers of the time. One thinks of Stendhal, Balzac, Flaubert, Tolstoy, and Robert Louis Stevenson. Every single great idea that fueled the driving force of the 19th century, freedom, human greatness, compassion, but also the subcurrents of history, uncovered by contemporaries such as the libido, the unconscious, and the uncanny, can be traced one way or another back to the horse. Of course, the horse is no sphinx, but the animal was certainly the bearer of many of the great ideas and imagery of the 19th century. It was its intellectual assistant, its speech therapist. Whenever 19th century man reached a mental brick wall, an emotional barrier, he would call upon his horse to help him advance. His horse was his flight animal that gave flight to ideas, his beast of burden who shared the burden of his suffering. In the background to the story of a separation that I will narrate in the following pages runs a process of sublimation. Just as the old solid world of horses, carriages, and cavalrymen begins to crumble under the pressure of an increasingly mechanized civilization, horses take on a more imaginary and chimeric form. They are reduced to an existence as the ghosts of modernity, and the more they forfeit their worldly presence, the more they haunt the minds of a humanity that is turned away from them. Perhaps this is the price we pay for the enormous loss of naive historical tradition, as Hermann Heimpel lamented at the 1956 annual German Historians Convention in Ulm. With every horse we lose, we also lose something of a way of life that connects our era with that of Charlemagne. When an era ends, as far as Karl Marx is concerned, and he himself quotes Hegel, what was historical drama makes a comeback as farce. Thus, at the dawn of its demise, the era of the horse flares up in one final comic glow. It was the glow of a reddish ponytail bobbing up and down enticingly as the door of history slammed shut in the background. It was 1957, the year Max Frisch's novel Homo Faber was published. The age of the centaurs was over. This was the first blush of the youthful era of schoolgirl Amazonian warriors wearing cowboy jeans, and Frisch worked hard to capture the contours. Her reddish ponytail dangling down over her back, her two shoulder blades under her black sweater, the notch in her firm and slender back, then her hips, her youthful thighs and her black trousers rolled up at the calves and her ankles. And yet all of these secondary details, her back, hips, thighs, calves, and ankles, are tertiary when seen against this combination of innocence and animality, this hurricane of social change about to sweep in. It would be another 7 years before the Ford Mustang became the appropriate mode of transport to ride out west. But the messenger of history was already fluttering enticingly, the ponytail that waved in the new era. The grandiose achievements made by horses during the era of the Centurion Pact were now, in the post-horse era, heading rapidly towards oblivion. However, the horse is not la part maudite of history, a page ripped out and crumpled up. It is simply a forgotten element. Though it might have been overlooked, its reach is extensive and complex. It is very tempting to narrate every aspect of equine history in one breath. The temptation is great to plunge in and get carried away, drifting between primary sources and theories, novels and reconstructions, bridles and destinies. As appealing as it might be, aesthetically speaking, it isn't a very practical approach. For the sake of dealing with stories systematically, I will introduce in succession the versions of history which, strictly speaking, should be told paratactically, that is, side by side. This will be done in the four sections of this book. In the first part, I will narrate real histories, the stories of cities, of roads, and of accidents, of rural doctors and cavalrymen, of spaces, paths, and energies. In part two, I'll focus on an intellectual, scientific, and academic history. This will be a narrative of the leading lights in the history of the equine knowledge developed by centuries of horse fanciers, breeders, painters, and scholars, now partially, if not totally, forgotten. In part three, I will discuss the horse as metaphor and the history of its representation. We will consider images and perceptions of horses through which the 19th century's ideas of power, freedom, might, compassion, and terror played out. In these three sections of the book, I reflect on three economies where the horse has played its ancient, pivotal role as a converter or conveyor of energy, of knowledge, and of pathos. In the fourth and final section, I gather together the narratives of horses and people I have heard, read, and experienced. I have ordered my material into categories as best I can, by tracing the contours of the three economies, by showing how the horse and its history have been presented by other historians, and finally, by proposing my own suggestions for tales that should be told. So, as we embark on a reenactment of the dramatic story of the horse, how should it be staged? Should it be framed as tragedy or farce, as an ascent or a decline, as cultural critique or detached structural analysis? The theme of separation, of leave-taking, suggests it would make sense to adopt the aesthetic form of the eulogy. After all, are we not bidding farewell to a living environment, a natural civilization, a sophisticated culture, an analog world? But this farewell is already done and dusted. It's a story that ended a good half a century ago. Is everything we might say about it not therefore more suited to be presented as an epilogue? Both approaches have something attractive about them, and I'm sure both would be effective on the stage. They might well give us an emotional picture, but how much would they offer in terms of knowledge? If we want to know how the story plays out and what it has to say to us, we might do better to adopt a more open, more porous approach. More comparisons, fewer conclusions. Besides, the history of the horse is not one suited to final words. The subject matter calls for an histoire totale, as I mentioned above, recounting how my earlier reflections came about. How little I knew then of the spirits I was summoning. For the sake of the horse, rivers of ink have flowed, creating an ocean of printed literature. But a synthesis such as I hope to achieve with this book will never escape the labyrinth of print. An all-encompassing archive remains a distant dream. The horse was born not in Troy, but in Alexandria. It is a phantom of the library. And whoever has experienced the representations in text and pictorial form with which this phantom has filled the minds of artists, writers, and scholars, indeed, colonized their thinking to the point of obsession, will struggle to recover that harsh word of the stable, the manège, and the pasture. That is not all. The epistemic problems run deeper and bring into question the possibility of representation itself. Whoever writes about 200 or 300 years of equine history begins to see himself hemmed in by dense heaps of literature on the role of the horse in various, very distinct cultural contexts. With every step he takes, he moves across chasms of scholarly controversies of which he can scarcely take stock, let alone render in his own words. 100 years of research into North American Indian anthropology cannot be neatly summarized in a handful of pages. Trying to be a scholar like Franz Boas, one risks ending up a genre novelist like Carl May. The sense of digging in a bottomless pit is one that will be familiar to all authors of synthetic history, especially global historians. With the plethora of references I litter throughout my text, I will, as far as possible, be laying my cards on the table. But the question of evaluation is perhaps one I managed to skirt around without truly answering it. More than something to have and hold, such a question is more of a desideratum, something to hope for or aim at. And the more garrulous the discourse, and the more scholars and specialists babble away, the more unmistakable is the silence of the real protagonist. The horse holds its tongue. Le cheval n'a pas de patrie. The horse has no fatherland, as Marshal Ney put it. But is it not high time to grant it leave to remain in our tales of the past? It is nearly 2 decades now since I first had the idea of writing the story of the long 19th century, focusing not on the usual suspects, from Napoleon and Metternich to Bismarck, but on the unsung hero and protagonist of this century, the horse. Back then, I still dreamed of giving a voice to this historic kingpin. If this dream has faltered, it is not for want of material or because of the obscurity of the subject. On the contrary, the archives are full and overflowing. One never writes from the stable, but always from the ivory tower of the library. When a writer grants the horse the lead role or even the first-person narrative voice, as we see with certain sensitive authors of equine and world literature, from Theodore Sedari, Memoir d'un Cheval d'Escadron, 1864, John Mills, Life of a Racehorse, 1865, Anna Sewell, Black Beauty, 1877, Leo Tolstoy, Klostermer, 1886, Mark Twain, A Horse's Tale, 1905, and D.H. Lawrence, St. Maur, 1925, to Michael Morpurgo, Warhorse, 1982. Their words do still stem from the ivory tower. I do not mean to suggest that we cannot truly get close to the special intelligence and emotional life of the horse. And indeed, I attempt, with a few brief references at the end of this book, to propose that it is possible. But nevertheless, I found that in what I initially hoped to achieve, I have failed. My first genuine horse book will have to wait until my rebirth as a horse. This tome in the hands of the reader is not the horse's book, but rather the work of a historian about the end of an era in which mankind and horses made history together. And I stress made it together, as clearly they didn't write it together. Only one party to the alliance did the writing, and one human life is not sufficient to read everything that mankind has had to say about the other side of the partnership. For a long time, I thought I would write this book for historians, as if the point was to reveal to my colleagues the historical protagonist they had overlooked all these years and the opportunities for understanding they had missed. I would still be happy if one single historian read my book and found a loose end tied up or a new beginning opened up. But in the end, I wrote it, to quote a charming, if immodest, dedication, for all and for none. That, too, is of course only partly true. I have written it for my mother, who loved horses and understood them. Whether she would have liked it, I will never know. 10 years have passed since I could have asked her. Part 1. The Centurion Pact. Energy. 6 stallions, say I can afford. Is not their strength my property? I tear along a sporting lord, as if their legs belonged to me. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. Faust, Part 1. Translated by P. Wayne, 1949. The centaur dominates the 19th century like a landmark. No other creature from the Greek fables and legends embodies quite so well the direction of movement of an age that was bewitched by the promise of increased energy. This is the era of the horseman, the creature who is more than man. The centaur is the very epitome of energy, the troublemaker in the mythological menagerie, a young ruffian who loves to carouse and get into fisticuffs. Invite him to dinner, and you risk more than a few broken dishes. No other mythological wild child carries within him such an ever-present possibility of violence. He's an explosive machine of strength and vitality, where man's wisdom and cunning combine with the horse's power and speed. He is wild belligerence coupled with methodical compulsion. What manifests itself as a centaur's aggression is a pure eruption of energy. In the world of this hoofed reveler, the female exists merely as a prey to be snapped up, as a Sabine to be whisked away. He might act the gallant gentleman and offer a beauty his hand to help her up onto his equine back, but the next moment he's galloping off with her, sparks flying in the air, trembling with erotic energy. When it comes to romance, he hasn't moved on much since the time of Ovid. On catching his first glance of a human male, the young centaur can only be disappointed. He sees a defective creature, a mere half a being. One day, as I walked in a valley where centaurs rarely roam, I chanced upon a human, writes Maurice de Guerin. It was the first upon which my eyes had fallen, and I despised him. This thing is but one half of what I am, I said to myself. This must surely be a centaur overthrown by the gods, which they have reduced to having to crawl along in such a manner. Man is well aware of his inferiority and weakness, and thus he seeks to domesticate and breed horses, to nurture and train them, the animal aspect of his mobile existence. The closer and stronger the bond between the two, the more centurion their partnership becomes, the greater the energy, power, and speed that is channeled to the rider holding the reins. It was inevitable that as the sun set on the era of the horse, a new centurion culture would arise, with their horseback battles for dominance, the cowboys and Indians of the American West, in the vein of the Mongols, Mamelukes, and Cossacks before them, brought to life the age-old fantasy of the fusion of man and beast for one last time, colonizing as they did so the minds of generations of children. The discourse about the impending demise of riding and horse-drawn transport started early, a human life before the first automobile tentatively rolled out onto the road. Prompted by a natural disaster, this discourse was the trigger for invention. In 1815, the eruption of Mount Tambora, a volcano on the Indonesian island of Sumbawa, to the east of Bali, darkened the sky of the southern hemisphere, and of the northern hemisphere the following year, to such an extent that the global drop in temperature caused a series of failed harvests. The consequences were widespread famines and rising oat prices. Horses competed for scarce grain and hay stocks, and either starved or had to be slaughtered and eaten out of severe food shortages, as hauntingly illustrated by Hans Erhard Lessing, an expert in the history of technology. This was the hour of the inventor. In 1817, Karl Drais revealed the first model of his dandy horse, or Laufmaschine, running machine, which he described as a horseless transportation device. The underlying intention from the start was to unilaterally terminate the old centurion pact, a contract that was unilaterally entered into in the first place. Once it was brought into the world, the conversation about the impending end of the horse era would never run dry. The fantastical spirit of innovation and experimentation kept the discourse alive until the late 19th century, when the process of phasing out and replacement started in earnest, powered by both electrical and internal combustion engines, and quickly gained momentum. A farewell ode to the old equine world, now sunk into oblivion, was published in 1935 under the title Das Reiterbuch. This rider book was the debut work of the as-yet-unknown psychologist, Alexander Mitscherlich. This young writer captured the look of the horseman and traced his changing appearance throughout the millennia. The splendor of the historical sunset glowed on every mountaintop, filled with the sweet sound of the elegy. The spotlight no longer falls on the horse and its rider. Their trotting tempo has faded away. Their hoof tracks are covered over. The domain of the horse has dwindled. The tracks man follows are of another timber, since he fell in step with the turbine's beat. Mitscherlich's historical review led to criticism of the mechanized and motorized civilization. In contrast to mankind's eternal tools, such as the sword and the steed, which served as a natural expansion and augmentation of man's strength, inspired by his original thinking, the machine robbed men of their vital expression. Mankind yields his physical expression and vitality to the neutrality of these machines, hiding himself inside the apparatus. In these total prostheses cowered a being who was depleted of strength and alienated from himself. The more of these prostheses are put into service, the weaker becomes the man whom they serve. Judging by the vocabulary Mitscherlich uses and the intellectual landscape he depicts, prosthetics, the neutrality of machine-generated energy, the disempowerment of the subject, his eulogy to the horseback rider who climbed down from the saddle and disappeared into the cab of his motorized vehicle belongs firmly in the context of a conservative perspective on culture and technology in the 1930s. In the form of a footnote to Ernst Jünger's book, The Worker, Der Arbeiter, Mitscherlich counters Jünger's aggressive techno-vision with sentimental, idyllic scene-setting. When, in the following pages, I describe how the horse, that animalistic supplier of energy, was replaced in various aspects of life, agriculture, the transportation of goods, public transport, the military, I won't adopt a mournful, elegiac tone, bemoaning the cultural changes. The dissolution of the Centurion Pact was not accompanied, after all, by the complete disappearance of our hoofed friend. On the contrary, since the all-time low of 250,000 horses in Germany in 1970, their number has again been on the increase and is now estimated at over a million. There are also thought to be over a million men and women regularly involved in equestrian activities in Germany, with a significant bias in favor of women and girls. The riding industry employs some 300,000 people in Germany, whether it's in breeding, veterinary services, training, or day-to-day care. People earn a living from riding equipment, riding lessons, staging competitive events, riding holidays, writing for equestrian magazines. The average German station bookshop stocks some 24 periodicals for the riding community. And then there's the specialist academic subject of equine studies, which students can study at several colleges in the Federal Republic. With undergraduate degree courses available in Berlin, Osnabrück, and Nürtingen, and a postgraduate master's course at Göttingen. Besides those who make a living in the equine industry, this revival of the horse age, filled with sporting achievements and tender love and care, has all but lost its former historic solemnity. The connections forged between humans and horses nowadays are relationships based on love, communities of interest, and sporting camaraderie. The Centurion Pact, by contrast, was made of much sterner stuff. It was a covenant of the old style, still governed by the law of necessity. People and horses were comrades in fate, that is, until the day when they went their separate ways. In this section, we'll look at how that came about and what happened next. Hell for horses. Since we've got the railroad, horses have been running worse than ever. Theodore Fontaine, The Stechlin, 1898. Translated by W. Zweibel, 1995. A Trinity with Dante. When playwright and poet Friedrich Schiller passed away in May 1805 after a long terminal illness, he left behind him a considerable number of unfinished plays. One of the drafts, entitled Die Polizei, The Police, was a tragedy set in pre-revolutionary Paris, a colossal amphitheater where citizens and information are subjected to sinister monitoring by the authorities. At the heart of the drama is the bureau of the omnipotent police chief. His real nemesis is not the shadowy criminal world, but the intrigues of the nocturnal city. Paris becomes a superhuman protagonist in its own right. As in most of the draft manuscripts cut short by Schiller's early death, the playwright had not yet made a start on the rhyming verse of the police drama. The play is instead sketched out in prose dialogue, swarming with excerpted quotations and draped with the fruits of his reading and turns of phrase he had picked up here and there. One of the most striking is the phrase, "Paris is paradise for women, purgatory for men, hell for horses." Schiller did not invent this memorable tripartite dictum. He merely tweaked the rhythm. Louis-Sébastien Mercier, whom he quotes, speaks of le paradis des femmes, le purgatoire des hommes et l'enfer des chevaux. For his Paris drama, the poet Schiller finds in Mercier's Tableau de Paris an inexhaustible source of quotations and observations. Schiller adopts from him the seemingly contemporary depiction of the police force as a great machine, along with the city as a kind of Moloch who comes into his own in the night. It is clear from the following sentence in Schiller's notes that he had not overlooked the demographic context of Mercier's aperçu. Mortality rate in P, 20,000 per year. This statistic is also derived from Mercier, who under the heading Population de la Capitale furnishes evidence that the men of Paris died at a more tender age than women. This, Mercier argues, is why people speak of Paris as the paradise of women and purgatory of men. Only the horses and flies dropped faster. But this elegant axiom was not coined by Mercier either. The trope about women, men, and horses was doing the rounds a whole 2 centuries earlier. It seems that it was the French author Bonaventure de Perrier who first composed the expression in 1558. In the 31st short story included in his posthumously published collection, Nouvelle Récréation et Joyeux de Vie, Paris is described as paradise for women, hell for mules, and purgatory for petitioners. Towards the end of the 16th century, John Florio, in his Second Fruits, was the first to express the idea in the classic formation, paradise for women, purgatory for men, hell for horses. And again, 30 years later in 1621, Robert Burton brought the concept of a paradise for women and hell for horses back to England in order to contrast his homeland with Italy, where everything is reversed, and it is the horses that are in paradise. But it was Mercier who brought the memorable phrase into such wide currency. This tricolon reminds us of Dante, who is never far away when it comes to talking about hell. But everyone made use of it to suit their needs. The canon of Hamburg Cathedral, F.J. L. Meyer, followed up his 1802 trip to France by publishing his Letters from the Capital and the Interior of France, Brief aus der Hauptstadt und dem Innern Frankreich, in which he praises the quality of the police and bemoans the lot of the horses in Paris. You can get there very cheaply, he writes, but the horses and their harnesses are in a dreadful state. Women, men, mortality rates, the whole demographic context is left out of the picture, and all that remains is the misery of the horses, which henceforth survives as a topos that spreads throughout the Parisian literature of the 19th century. It comes up again in the work of Edouard Koloff, the Paris correspondent for the morning journal for educated readers, Morgenblatt für gebildete Leser, published by Cotta. Koloff reported in 1838 on the Paris transport industry and employed the following description of the hellish traffic in the capital. When one sees the great quantity of carriages that trundle back and forth ceaselessly through the streets of Paris from morning till night, one wonders how it is possible that there are still pedestrians to be encountered on the sidewalks. Cabriolets, fiacres, deltas, lutetiens, tilburys, barouches, caleches, coupes, landaus, gigs, curricles, four-horse postchaises, six-horse diligences, all of these ride up and down, day in, day out, weaving and winding, breaking axles, tipping over, causing untold accidents in the French capital, which has long been known as a paradise for women, but has more right to be known by its other nickname, a hell for horses, and equally fitting would be hell for pedestrians. See Plate 2. Even among Arab diplomats and writers, a hell for horses is a familiar watchword. Among them is the vizier Ibn Idris Muhammad al-Amrawi, who in 1860 visited the court of Napoleon III as an emissary of Sultan Mohammed IV of Morocco, 1859 to 1873. Al-Amrawi adopts the formula from his experienced predecessor, the Egyptian Sheikh Rafia al-Tatawi, who had traveled to France a few years earlier. The vizier shows little interest in the demographics of Paris or in the traffic conditions in the capital. In his eyes, the reference takes on a slightly different significance. He refers to the dominance exerted by women within their domiciles and sometimes even beyond their walls. The Oriental visitor senses a cultural danger in the power wielded by women, which makes it advisable, as far as he is concerned, to keep one's distance from the West. The sight of the Frenchman's horses prompts condescension from the Arab connoisseur. Excellent horses, such as we have, are not to be found over there. The gentlest touch. the Tableau de Paris, Mercier's panorama of the Paris of the 1780s on the eve of the Revolution, consists of numerous prose sketches or essays which read like the captions to paintings. The entire composition breaks down into kaleidoscopic shards, a series of frames, many filled with mayhem, shouting, shoving, the hustle and bustle, clamor and odors of the city. Like the illustrations of a children's book, swarming and teeming with activity, in Mercier's detailed descriptions, we recognize characters, familiar faces, well-known scenes. There is also one particular ever-present protagonist, whom we see lurking in every shadowy corner of his intricate cityscape, utterly indifferent to the topic under discussion, be it the spirit, the economy, wealth, the state of the city, or the morals and health of its residents. Whatever the headlines, the gossip, the talk of the day, the horse always turns up where you least expect it. In such moments, Mercier's great cityscape almost becomes a novel about the two species sharing a common space. In the tableau, the tale of the grandeur et misère reveals an exceedingly close cohabitation. We speak of biocenosis, an ecological community where several species live together in one space, one biotope. In this narrative, there are only two species sharing the biotope, their common habitat, while all their other fellow residents, the city's dogs, cats, rats, pigeons, are pushed out of the picture, historically speaking. In the urban realm, the coexistence of people and horses is perceived as a ménage à deux. Of course, humans and animals cohabit very closely in the countryside too, and have done since time immemorial, even sharing one roof, cozying up in one household, or cynocism. But in a rural farmstead, the horse is not a farmer's only housemate. The domain is also shared with cows, oxen, sheep, goats, pigs, geese, and hens, not to mention the mice, lice, and other parasites. The lives of humans and animals are often divided by only a very thin wall. One hears the other eating and chattering. One is aware of the other's smells, and both chase away the same flies. The city, with its reduced biodiversity, gives the impression of allowing men and horses greater distance from one another. In truth, they are welded more closely together than ever, with the common habitat that is imposed on them merging the two tribes into a common destiny. All this is not without friction or tension. Reports of late 18th and 19th century Paris echo complaints about cramped conditions and the stench of the city, the dangers for pedestrians, the cacophony of the horse-drawn carriages. There are still places in Europe where we get a sense of how a horse-filled city must have looked and smelled. In Vienna and Rome, there are squares where fiacres and dozing horses wait for tourists. But can we imagine how a 19th century city would have sounded? Everyone knows the rumble of a scooter on its nocturnal newspaper delivery rounds, the screech of a tram, the honking of taxis, and the death knell of a braking bus. But who can conjure up the cracking whips, the wagon wheels and horseshoes on the cobbles in the early morning hours when sleep is fragile and ephemeral? The roar of the city becomes unbearable when the two species, horses and humans, come into too close quarters, when a rough carriage driver thrashes his weary beasts of burden. Arthur Schopenhauer denounced the cracking of whips as the most irresponsible and shameful din, which breaks the concentration of one who labors with his mind. This sudden, sharp thwack, which slices through one's brain and shatters one's thoughts, must strike agony into every man who carries anything so much as resembling a thought in his head. The emotional effect on the horse, which is surely intended to be the same, is dulled, and indeed annulled, by the habitual use and incessant abuse of the thing. The horses do not accelerate their pace in response, even when driving an empty fiacre on the prowl for custom. Trotting at the slowest tempo, they swat away constantly. The gentlest touch of the whip would be much more effective. The clamour of horses, carriages, and coaches sets the pulse of the trembling city. Mercier describes how, at every hour of the day, the noise of the city subtly changes. From early morning until dusk, the soundscape shifts with each hour that passes. The worst is the racket at about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, when everyone is driving towards each other, pushing to get past, clogging up the roads. At 7 o'clock in the evening, the noise fades out, the city becomes still. The workers go home on foot, but by 9 the clamor rises anew as the bourgeoisie head out to the theater. Around midnight, silence reigns again, broken only by the occasional rumble of the cabs bringing city dwellers home. At 1 o'clock in the morning, 6,000 farmers descend upon the city, laden with vegetables, fruit, and flowers. By 2 o'clock, the gigs and coaches of those returning late to their beds tear Parisians from their sleep. In Mercier's prose, we hear not only the stagecoaches rattling and the horseshoes clattering on the cobbles, but we also sense the growing awareness among city dwellers of the din created by the sheer numbers of their equine companions. The rhythm which pulsed through the city would not change for some time. When Emile Zola wrote of the belly of Paris 100 years later, the noise that echoes around day and night is this same infernal din. And those who are to blame for it are also the same people. Every 13th Frenchman. On the 18th of January 1766, a dispute arose at the edge of the Place de Victoire between a cab driver and an elegant aristocrat, the consequences of which were investigated by the police and registered in the archives. A driver stopped to let out his customer. On seeing that he and his own carriage were thus prevented from moving forward, the aristocratic gentleman flared up in anger and, stepping down from his carriage, beat the horse with his sword and stabbed it in the abdomen. He was eventually made to pay the cab driver for the care of the injured horse. The signature on the ensuing legal document was that of an irascible character whose name went down in history as a byword for cruelty, the Marquis de Sade. As early as the mid-18th century, Paris was the horse capital. The political, economic, and cultural revival that Paris underwent, briefly interrupted by the Revolution, but then strongly reinvigorated, was unthinkable without a great number of horses in the capital city. The horse at once represented the economic means and the energy required for everything that Paris had on show, everything that made the world marvel. From the new forms of symbolic politics and real warfare, the exercise of cultural hegemony, the rapid circulation of money, goods, and news, the spread of the arts and fashion, to the ostentatious display of wealth and a certain savoir-vivre. Nearly 80,000 horses populated the city at the height of the horse era in 1880. In the capital, we see the reflection of a nation rich in horses. In 1789, on the eve of the Revolution, almost 2 million horses grazed the pastures of France. By 1850, their number had increased to nearly 3 million, a level which remained consistent with only slight fluctuations until the First World War. Had it not been for the loss of Alsace-Lorraine, France would have owned an estimated 3.8 million horses on the eve of the First World War. Of course, the human population also rose, from 36.5 million in 1852 to 41 million in 1906. But the ratio of one species to the other, of horses to men, changed by only one percentage point. Even then, every 13th Frenchman was a horse. Yet France was by no means in first place in terms of national horse populations. In the UK in the 19th century, there was one horse for every 10 residents. Well, in the USA, the ratio was 1 to 4, and in Australia, it was 1 to 2. In the late 19th century, there were 300,000 horses living in London. Although the 19th century city developed a higher requirement for horses than at any previous point in history, the number of horses per human inhabitant in the densely populated agglomerations was still likely to be lower than in the rest of the nation. Even between cities, within one country, there were differences, as we see in the United States, for instance. The more spacious and provincial-feeling cities of the Midwest had a far higher ratio of horses to men than the highly compressed metropolises of the East Coast. Even where the ratio was only 26.4 inhabitants per horse, as in New York in 1900, the absolute numbers are still staggering. Imagine what life must have been like in Manhattan when there were some 130,000 horses working within the city at any one time. What must it have felt like to walk along Broadway and have to dodge horse carcasses and carriages wedged into gridlock? How must a city like New York in 1900 have reeked when its horses produced 1,100 tons of manure and 270,000 liters of urine daily, and when 20 dead horses were transported away every day? The figures are even higher for the considerably larger city of London. At the Knacker's Yard, 26,000 horses per year were turned into cat food and fertilizer. Photographs from those times convey only a pale reflection of the cramped coexistence humans and horses had to endure in the city at the fin de siècle. The life of one species means the death of the other. For the horses living in and consumed by the 19th century city, seized by the storm of mechanization, it was no healthy environment. Their muscles, tendons, hooves, and joints could only endure the harsh work of providing draft power for the urban modes of transport for a few years, before they were sold on for commercial use to pull lighter loads, or allowed to return for their final years to the countryside. City horses went into retirement at the age of 5 and had an average lifespan of 10 years. This was true of omnibus horses, while tram horses tended to be exhausted after 4 years. For many, the end came even sooner, by way of permanent lameness, a sad fate concluded with a veterinarian's bullet. Between 1887 and 1897, the employees of the New York ASPCA, American Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals, put down between 1,800 and 7,000 horses annually. Contrary to the popular notion, the dead animal was not left to rot in the gutter. The disposal of carcasses was a mechanized process. A winch, powered by horsepower, hauled it onto a cart, a tarpaulin was thrown over it, and it was transported out of the city. In the cities of European countries, where horse meat was eaten, you would often see groups of horses, many limping on 3 legs, making their weary way to the slaughterhouse. In France, owners had their horses shaved before slaughter to make use of the horsehair. Mid-century Paris saw growing indignation among the populace at the desperate sight of shorn horses on their last legs. The increasing reliance on horses for the expansion and mechanization of urban transport changed the relationship of the city to the surrounding countryside. No longer were farms responsible only for supplying vegetables, meat, and milk for consumption by the human population of the city. Throughout the course of the 19th century, they increasingly took on the role of breeding and supplying the dietary needs of the city horses. The requirements of the horse industry opened up new, lucrative business opportunities. A horse-based economy, say the American historians Clay McShane and Joel A. Tarr, demanded enormous inputs of land, labor, and capital. The horse-powered economy required massive amounts of land, both for grazing in rural areas before migration and for food supplies after. The 3 million horses that inhabited the cities of the United States in 1900 consumed 8 million tons of hay and almost 9 million tons of oats per year. 12 million acres of land were needed to produce that quantity of fodder, about 4 acres per horse. It was not only for inner city traffic that the demand for horses rose. From the late 18th century, horses also finally took over from the ox and the ass as the main supplier of draft power in farming, plate 5. The main reasons for this shift, besides the expansion and improvement of the road network and road paving, were improvements made to vehicles and agricultural tools, namely the plow and harrow, later also the mower. Speed became the most important factor in the economy. Saving time reaped profits. Thanks to its speed, the horse more than made up for what the ox offered in terms of power and modest nutritional requirements. The constantly growing demand for horses from this point on led to a similar increase in the number of stud farms. By the mid-century, horse breeding was at the heart of the agricultural system of most European and North American countries. No other agricultural product, be it meat, crops, or wool, held anything like as high a systemic value. The horse provided something that would become more important and more fundamental for the modern economy than protein, carbohydrates, and textiles: the provision of energy in a pure, immediately available form, with no further requirement for transformation or transference. If, as Michel Foucault put it, the régime scolaire produced the scholars, that is, the pupils and students, and the régime pénitentiaire governed the inmates of the modern penal system, so the modern agricultural regime produced the familiar repertoire of proteins, fats, and carbohydrates, but above all, animal-powered kinetic energy, which by the 19th century was supplied mainly by horses. The great powerhouse of the horse provided the prerequisite for the modern logistics and transportation systems in the expanding cities. Of course, the domestication and breeding of a second abile animal, besides the Homo habilis, came at a price, and was not without social and technical preconditions. Breakdown in the system. Paris, the 19th century world capital, was also the capital of traffic. It was little wonder there were so many accidents. Wherever there is mention of the traffic, sooner or later we hear of an accident. Regardless of who or what supplies the motive power, be it horse, ox, locomotive, or combustion engine, there always seems to be an injury or fatality in the margin of the texts dealing primarily with the technical means, costs, and risks of the act of transportation. It begins with Icarus, and Concord was not the end of it. Each and every mode of transport brings with it inherent risks and its own distinctive kind of accident. In the history of technology, each epoch has its own true stories chapter, cataloging the associated disasters as though it were in the mishaps, the collisions, the pileups, and the systemic breakdowns that we see the true essence of a technology. Again, Mercier presents himself as an early and fruitful informant. Cabs and cabbies cause untold accidents, he writes in Gare, Gare, which do not interest the police in the slightest. To lend legitimacy to his critique of the traffic system, Mercier draws on his own experiences. He was present at one of the earliest urban pileups, at least of those that were recorded. I witnessed the disaster on the 28th of May, 1770. Its cause was a mass of vehicles blocking the road, across which poured the most enormous stream of people, a huge crowd in the dim light of the boulevards. By a hair's breadth, I avoided losing my life. 12 to 15 people were killed, either on the spot or later as a consequence of their injuries, having been crushed so terribly. 3 times I was hurled to the ground, each time by a different coach, and I was almost crushed alive under the wheels of one. It was not the criminality of certain residents that made the city of the late 18th and 19th century a dangerous place, but the forced centaurism, the horse-powered street traffic, the obligatory close coexistence of men and horses. Throughout the 19th century, the number of accidents in the cities and on the highways rose steadily, caused by bolting horses, overturning carriages, collisions, and driving at excessive speeds. In 1867, horse-powered transportation on the streets of New York caused an average of 4 fatalities per week, with another 40 pedestrians injured. In other capitals, the incidence of accidents was also well above what is typical of today's motorized traffic. Even at the beginning of the 20th century, when automobiles were beginning to be found on the streets, the cause of traffic accidents was still overwhelmingly the use and abuse of horses. 53% of accidents registered in France in 1903 involved horse-drawn carriages, 1/3 in the cities, 2/3 on the country roads. Figures for the United States around the turn of the century come out at an annual average of 750,000 accidents and serious injuries. The literature of the 19th century, whether descriptions of cities or travel, is full of lamentation about reckless drivers, drunken coachmen, toppling carriages, injured passers-by, and terror-stricken travelers. It's not the dreaded highwayman who is the traveler's worst enemy, but his best friend, the horse. But the beast is not the true cause of the accident. The problem is the system of horse-drawn transport, with all the associated cab drivers, riders, travelers, hauliers, and policemen, and all the vehicles, harnesses, and other equipment. A not inconsiderable role is played by the lamentable condition of the paths and roads, and the poor monitoring of the speed of the moving elements within the system. If we want to dig down to the root cause of so many accidents, we need to look at the Centurion system as a whole, considering all the individual parts that make up the entire horse-powered ensemble, evaluating how the players interact and how each element is articulated. It all starts with the intrinsic nature of the lead player. Horses are flight animals, easily startled and quick to resort to their instinctive flight reflex. A sudden movement in their peripheral vision, the bark of a dog, a sheet of newspaper caught by the wind, and that's it. Before you know it, the horse loses its head and bolts. A bolting horse can have fatal consequences, especially in the crush of the city, and if other horses are also alarmed. The largest horse-related catastrophe in recorded history was in New York in 1823, involving a chain reaction of panicking horses. Urban workhorses need to become accustomed to the traffic and the sights and sounds of the city. Just as in a military context, warhorses need to become attuned to gunfire and cannons. But not only did the industry need horses to be bred and trained in a certain way, the men working in this new environment also had to adjust to the increasingly complex and fast-moving traffic conditions. The human animal also needed training to cope with the challenges of modern traffic. The drunken cabbie, given to spouting profanities and reckless driving, was no longer merely a nuisance for sensitive souls, a moral irritant. He had become a risk factor. He needed to be put in his place. Rules needed to be imposed and their compliance monitored by the police and, where necessary, enforced by the courts. Efforts to regulate the speed of horse traffic go back as far as the Renaissance. In a decree of 1539, Francis I of France spoke for the first time of the dangers of speeding, overtaking, and turning abruptly in the streets of the cities and on the highways of the kingdom. Yet it was not until the end of the 17th century that the first steps were taken by police forces to confront excessive speeding and careless driving. It was around 1780 that a new invention started to appear on the streets in England and France, one of those developments explored so eloquently by Bruno Latour, which, in a seamless solution to both social and technical challenges, was able to protect urban pedestrians and implement a physical division of the road by creating different levels. What we are talking about is, of course, the trottoir, or pavement, a clearly delineated, elevated walkway whose curbstone forms a physical border between the carriageway of moving vehicles and the dedicated space for pedestrians. The curb, this partition of a mere hand's breadth, which just decades later snaked for hundreds of kilometers throughout the entire city, is not merely a response in urban architectural form to the creeping centralization of the metropolis and its inhabitants. If the growth of the city in the 19th century profoundly changed the ecology of the countryside and the economy of agriculture by placing the horse at the center of the agricultural system, then it also in turn led to changes in the horse's ecology and the architecture of the city. The tens of thousands of horses living and working in the cities needed not only to be fed and watered, they also required accommodation. On a scale that is barely imaginable now, the 19th century city consisted of rows upon rows of urban stables, whose often haphazard construction out of wood and brick made them a liability in terms of both sanitary conditions and fire safety. Boston in 1867 boasted some 367 stables, each housing on average 7.8 horses. These stable blocks were dotted across the entire city, with work and transport horses deployed at the port and the railway stations, while the riding and carriage horses of the well-to-do needed to be housed within easy reach of their owners. Just like the outbuildings with coach houses below and coachmen's living quarters above that are still to be found today in the courtyards of European townhouses or the Mews lanes of London, The stables were mostly located behind the houses or accommodated in the central courtyard of a block of dwellings. Most had one or possibly two stories, though in some cases, three or four-story stables were built. In the largest bus depot in southwest London, 700 horses were accommodated on two floors around a huge square courtyard. Just as the cramped cohabitation of people and horses had altered the structure and the infrastructure of aristocratic life, including the installation of palace staircases for horses, so too had the obligatory centralization of the 19th century altered its architectural features. This was also a boom time for street furniture. From the middle of the 19th century onwards, European and American cities were enhanced by the installation of troughs and drinking fountains for horses. The ASPCA counted over 100 in 1890. One of the grandest drinking spots for horses was set up on West 155th Street in New York in 1894, thanks to a legacy left by the entrepreneur John Hooper. Besides a large drinking trough for the horses, the fountain, designed by George Martin Huss, included a number of smaller drinking points at ground level for dogs and a tap for the people of the city. The Golden Age. There was another significant factor in the tension between city and country. A certain crop had a very important place at the intersection of technology and society, particularly the upper class elites, and that crop was oats. In addition to hay and water, oats represent the main fuel in a horse-drawn economy. Oats are rich in protein and good for horses' sensitive digestive system. Oat straw is also nutritious. With the increased use of horses, there was a clear spike in the cultivation of oats to fill their bellies. And as the use of horses declined, so too did the oat fields. The increasing use of maize as a plant-based biofuel supply in the current energy market recalls the upsurge in oat production in the 18th century. Oats boost a horse's vitality and bring a shine to it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.